They taught me again and again. Little by little I learned to forget, to forgive, and to laugh. Slowly the hatred faded away.
In 2007, the results of the Kenyan national election were contested and intertribal violence broke out all over the country. More than 1,200 people were murdered and hundreds of thousands ended up internally displaced. One group of approximately 6,000 people ended up in the town of Nakuru, about 200 kilometres northwest of Nairobi. The UNHCR established a camp for them and this is what they've called home for the past 7 years. In 2010, a New Zealand woman, Cassandra Treadwell, set up a Sydney-based NGO called So They Can. Went to the elders of the camp and asked what she could do to support them. They asked her for a school.
If we deny our children education at this level, we will not be able to change Kenya.
If we need to solve our problem, we need to be educated.
Recognising that education was really the only way to break the poverty cycle. In May 2010, the Aberdare Rangers Primary School opened its doors to 120 fully sponsored students.
Hello, how are you?
School is going to be a school that everybody is looking upon. We are going to make these children become children that are going to be very important in our country.
When you're in need, like the way the people in the camp are, and you're not able to support your kid, you're not able to do anything, then if somebody comes all the way from Australia to come and help your kid, that is something that you'll never forget.
That same year, two Notre Dame students, both studying to be teachers, volunteered at the school. And we've developed a long-term, sustainable and mutually beneficial relationship based around the concept of service learning. And in 2014, we sent 48 students, a doctor and 5 staff.
Jumbo, jumbo bwana, habari gani, nzuri sana, wageni, wakaribishwa.
Everybody was excited. At the end of the day, none of us really knew what to expect. So it was a little bit, there was a lot of mystery kind of going into it. Like it was just that excitement that we're here, we're ready to do it. We've been planning it for months beforehand. It was finally here.
There's a lot of, I suppose, planning in terms of what's going to take place once they're actually in Kenya. So all the logistics around their homestays, homestay accommodation, what they'll be doing in the school, what they'll be doing, you know, at the children's home as well, are all there.
It only really hit me on the first weekend where I realised where I was and how different it was. And in Tim's lectures, he'll mention Kenya and you can tell how passionate he is about the entire process, the project, continuing it. I was prepared for it. There's only so much you can prepare for chaos. Organised chaos, I guess.
They'd been living in this, what was called an internally displaced people's camp up until this point, but they have decided that there's no intention of going back to where they were originally from. This is their community now. They work beautifully together as a community now, and so they don't want to be considered to be displaced anymore, and so they've changed the name of the community there to a New Canaan village.
The tent gets knocked open, the house gets built just in a couple of days. Corrugated iron sheets and timber frame, very simple. The guys from the local community will get involved in the building of it. It's just beautiful. So for about $1,000 Australian, they move out of a tent and suddenly they're in this. So if you get them into a proper house, the health outcomes improve enormously. So over the last couple of years, Notre Dame students have paid for the building of 45 of these new dwellings, and there's 25 to go.
I prepared myself for
bucket showers and 45-minute walks to school, and I fully was like, cool, I'll wash my hair in 2 weeks. It was, I don't know, I was just like, cool, just say yes.
I came here thinking, oh my god, I don't know how I'm going to do this. By the second day, I was like, fuck it, same thing as a shower. Like, it's all the same end result, they just have their different methods of doing it.
The school has these big walls and this big metal door made to keep out vandals or animals, everything else. When you go in though, it's you're just swamped by kids. They just run at you and they've got no idea of personal space.
Whoa!
Yeah, we're gonna see
your muscles.
You
wanna see it again?
Yes.
In your country, is it hot?
Sometimes it's summer. It's hot in summer.
Are you in Notre? What's your name?
They just want to hold your hand or hold your arm. They just want to be around you. They'll come up and constantly be asking you questions and, you know, or just smiling at you. So it was very, very overwhelming and at first.
Good morning, boys and girls. I think we're very good. We're very happy to be here. It's wonderful to be with you again. And we look forward to working with you in the next few weeks. And thank you to your teachers for having us back at your school.
Thank you.
Finding
magic.
Thank you.
Mary Macharia, 4 lion. Next year, 5 lion. God willing.
God willing.
Hello?
Hi, I'm Lucia ECD.
Hi, Lucia.
Hi.
I'm major sports.
Only major.
I'm Jumbo.
Jumbo.
I'm Josephine.
I'm three zebra.
Please
to the floor. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hi.
Again, you wait.
So they can, their main interest is education and community development, and they were having some problems with the school attendance rates. So the children were essentially not getting to school often enough because of their health. And so they can helped develop a medical clinic in the IDP camp, which is now known as the New Canaan Village. Another goal is to really improve the capacity of the clinic at the camp and really make ourselves redundant.
And his friend Joseph is also now doing the camp to talk to you as well. So this is a really special opportunity. Moses.
Okay. There's a great change from 2008. There are fewer tents, but more houses. And this has happened because we have many hands who came together to help the community. And the challenges that we're facing, we have also the medical issues, because the clinic, the hospital that we are to attend is quite a distance from here. And so they can found it that we need to have a clinic that can be catering the community around.
hope and their smiles were unbelievable, and it just like you feel like you're exactly the same as them, but we were just born somewhere else.
Yes.
I just want to talk to you before we get started today on this amazing little voyage, and I think you can see straight away that this is going to be something a bit special. I want to talk to you about a concept called abundance. And abundance is this idea that our cup overflows. What we've been given, what we have, is more than we need. Your generation gets a rough time for being self-centered and inward focused. You guys are a true representation of the fact that that's not always the case. What you're going to experience in the classrooms here and in the clinic and up in the village and wherever we take ourselves is something very special, something that will stay with you for life. And as Natalie said to me this morning over breakfast, allow this to become a defining moment in your life.
Oh, thank you.
You wash every day? Yes?
I think that notion of, you know, having some, you know, farming areas set aside where they can actually grow their own crops, you know, the kale that's grown, that's, you know, used in their lunches, in order to, you know, make it a sustainable environment for the kids. It was great, yeah.
Yeah, this is our farm.
So these cows, on first viewing, these are healthy looking cows. Yeah.
You got to purchase a cow, especially first of all, it has to be healthy.
Yeah. Julie and I had a plan to purchase a cow for the children's home. And so we decided that what we would do is to try and buy a cow or two. Because we have a doctor with us here.
Yeah.
And it's his opinion that if they can have 200 mils of milk a day each, it will completely change their health outcomes.
So how many children that's
120 children.
120, that comes to 24 liters.
Yeah.
You've got to consider that it's got to be sustainable.
Yeah, yeah. That's our primary motivation.
Sustainability.
Yeah.
I wouldn't worry about anything else. Eh?
Yeah. This one? You feeling and eventually, you know, an amount was agreed on and two pregnant cows were purchased, which was a wonderful thing. This is 4,000. I'll show you how it is. That's 1,800.
37, 13, 3,000.
So what do you know about preference? Buying cows, Julie?
You've got to have an affinity for them. It's in the eyes.
In the eyes.
Whose eyes? Yours or theirs?
Mine.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
Unbeknownst to the owner.
Yeah.
The owner didn't realise that they were actually pregnant at the time of purchase. So it was a bonus for us in many ways.
As it turns out, yeah, we got four for the price of two. And right from day one, those cows were being milked. And one of the sort of projects, the sort of sustainable projects that Julie and I are really interested in being involved in.
She's making cow eyes.
Jumbo! They're just walking to school.
How are you, Jane?
I'm fine, thanks. Yes. How are you
on the holiday? Cool. Hey, you're a big one, you're a big one. Keep it up.
It's all well and good to have a planning day back at Notre Dame on campus. But to physically be in the environment of a classroom that's so different to anything that you've experienced, you have to be quick, you have to think on your feet, you have to make decisions, you have to take control and be really confident. And I think that's been one of the steepest learning curves I've seen on the trip in terms of their teaching abilities.
Okay. Very good, Denny.
Things that we've looked at is growth in confidence and growth in leadership skills. And the confidence being the most important aspect of that. The students have been put in situations that are unfamiliar to them. As a result of having to think on their feet and watching things work well and watching things not work, they're developing a really strong repertoire of teaching skills, which is really making them a lot more confident in their own abilities.
Most of our lessons were really, really well. I know, like, I had two other girls in my little teaching team kind of thing, and I don't know, we all just kind of bounced off each other. We had similar teaching styles and the kids just fed off it. Like, it was great. Everything kind of worked. Like, we'd planned typical games that we played at school, you know, like hangman and heads down, thumbs up, and these kids were like, what? And because, like, we've learnt quite a bit of Swahili, like, we're putting up Swahili words, and the kids were like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, like they got so into like silly little games like that.
Ew, ew, shh, ew, ew, shh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
And then we did like some origami, like the chatterboxes, and they were just like, what is this? Like their eyes just lit up. It's some tie-dye. Oh my gosh, the tie-dye, they just... they're still wearing the little bandanas that we made, and they're still like, can we do more? Can we do more? And I'm like, we don't have any tie-dye. They're like, why? They just loved it. And they're dipping it different ways and different colours, but made green and made purple, and they were just like, whoa! Like, they were so fascinated.
How's this workshop going?
Yeah, very nice. Getting creative.
Stuff.
You want some potato stamps?
Yeah. Very nice. Sante.
Either way, I think everything will work good. So, yeah, they love everything you do.
Definitely. Last week, I was with Maddie and Caitlin. We had these little shells to make it sort of an undersea under the water. theme, and then they all drew fish and they were all sort of discussing what animals were under the sea. And yeah, they came up with a few. They came up with like starfish and octopus, and some knew a lot and then others didn't know much at all, and they all really chipped in and helped each other out. And after a few had drawn them, others would sort of like look over and be copying them, and but they'd all colour them in different ways and decorate them.
I reckon what time I spent at the school was the highlight. Just interacting with the kids, just having fun with them. Back in Australia, you don't really get that chance to do that as much. But here, yeah, there's not really that many limitations as what you can do.
I was in a year five classroom last week, and I had a bunch of kids that were sitting up at the back every single day, five or six of them, and they just didn't want to be there, they just didn't like the activities. And I think towards the last couple of days, I really cracked them and earned their respect by learning a bit of Swahili, by singing a song they liked.
What song did you sing?
It was Kama Usapende Yesu Seme Amen. And they really like respected me after I learned that song, and then they sort of switched on, engaged a bit more, took part in the activities and just had a bit more of a focus.
Look at that!
All of the children at the school are given a hot meal every day. They're given like a porridge for breakfast in the morning when they arrive at school. And then they're actually given a meal at lunchtime.
Well, there was a great story from 2012 from our second trip when a student named Katie Wagstaff, who's got some skills as a sewer, decided that she'd like to share those skills when she was over there. And so she took over a sewing machine, which she purchased herself, and taught some of the local women how to use that machine. And subsequently, through some fundraising she's organised, they've got several other sewing machines and an overlocker now.
Right now we're just making bracelets for that we sell, and all the proceeds go to running So Women Can.
One of the classrooms at the school has been taken over as a sewing room, and all the school uniforms are made by these local women using these machines, and so that's really empowering for the local women and has worked brilliantly as a microfinancing project that's supported by So They Can. Slum tourism is such a big issue in developing countries. And I suppose the way that we really address that most is we go there with locals. So Nick and Gibson, who are two beautiful local men, you know, facilitate that for us. They're well known at the dump site. their elders come out and welcome us.
So they're going to get a bag each, of the mums here. We're going to come past. So anyone who wants to come and help with handing out that food, we're just going to give them a bit of everything. We've got some flour, some sugar, some salt, some cooking fat. And then they're going to take that away so that they can get on with their work at the dump. And what do you do here now? What does your day look like?
Just working here. I have one pig.
You have one pig?
Yeah, I raise it.
Yeah. And these children, do most of the children here, do they go to school or not?
Yeah, they all go to school.
They all go to school. Yeah. When you're working, when you're going through the rubbish, what are you looking for?
There's some stuff we look for, some plastics, metals.
To sell?
Yeah,
to sell.
Yeah.
And food as well?
Yeah, all of the bunch of there.
Always looking for food.
So we hope one day that Esther Watere, through breaking this kind of situation by education, maybe this will be transformed to be something better than this.
They're very shy. They don't have enough food. They didn't have shelter, so they have to be compromised by having boys, sleeping with boys, so that they can get shelter and a little bit of something to eat. Because during the days they were a little bit shy, they couldn't fight for that share. And that is how that spreads very quickly.
So they sell themselves to eat. And
they don't even sell themselves. They don't know whether it's, they can do that. They just have it.
Yes.
Is it illegal? Is it legal? They don't know. Mm. So those are the challenges that are facing the girl child here. Mm. No one is saved. The girls are not saved. The boys are as well as not saved.
Kwanza mimi naweza sema asante sana kwa sababu ya Esther Watere.
She's saying she's very, extremely happy to see you here. Coming to this, to knock on our door, she hardly gets somebody to knock on our door to say hello. You've now have a comparison that you can see how education can change life.
The kids who've come from the rubbish dump and are now living in the children's home are provided with an education at the Aberdare Rangers Primary School. And they're now living in what could only be described as a haven compared to where they were.
Very slow. You get the hospitals dumping here. You know, used needles that have been used in the hospitals, broken glasses from the hospitals, and all the refuse from the hospitals, they are dumped here. You know, as children, they are out, they don't know, they just go through that.
necklaces and the pencil cases really use what they have around them, and they don't have that much at all.
A lady was saying, education is not about having all the material, it's just having the knowledge to live healthy, making the right decision by having good education. It's not about having a nice car, a big house, going for holiday. It's just having the inner peace. You can only have the inner peace when your neighbor is as happy as you.
The real sense of community at the dump site.
You know, in the midst of abject poverty, that, you know, a human being can still maintain that sense of hope.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Provision of health checks for a lot of children is really it's a great vehicle for teaching fundamental clinical medicine to first year medical students. So very simple things like checking blood pressures and looking in ears and listening to chests and checking vision and height and weight and BMIs. All of those things are really cornerstones of clinical examination, and they're very important. But it's also an excuse for a clinical interaction with the child. You know, learn how to not lean over a child, for example, but sit down in a low chair so that the child instinctively feels less threatened, things like that. The children come in and go on a conveyor belt, really, of examinations. So each student is just responsible for one little task, and then they rotate those tasks from day to day.
88 beats per minute.
But the spectrum has also changed over the last 3 years as the public health state has improved. That is, if you improve sanitation, housing and water supply, then you can change and reduce instances of illness. Oh, they're very capable. They're probably far more capable than I was at that stage of the game. It's great to see their confidence change, even over the two-week period. Fantastic by the end. So we became quite a close-knit group, and we were all, you know, incredibly happy, giving ourselves high fives today, having completed all the children.
Put it on your forehead, okay? Next. There we go. Beautiful. Beautiful.
I think there's been a real significant shift in the number of students who are actually taking ownership of their own initiatives. You know, started putting together birthing kits because of the research they've done and the reading they've done around, you know, birthing in these marginalised communities is probably, you know, one of the things that's really stood out for me.
If I was asked, I could have said, "You stay in Kenya forever, your lovely Grace." So she wrote me this letter. And she actually stays in the village, and she's asked me to go and meet her family, which I'm hoping to do this week. Yes. Oh, and one of the other students today, Mary, drew a picture of me.
We're in such privileged positions as being educators, being doctors. We interact with people permanently, always, daily. And I think those interactions can have such power if we use something like our experience today and feed that forward.
When I go back, I'm upset at where I am, I think that I'm jealous. I'm very, very jealous of the way that people live here. And there's a lot I think I need to change about myself, and I think I will change when I get home.
I went to the village. This is my home. Welcome to my home. And when we went to the rubbish dump, this is my home. Welcome in. And they were so happy with everything that they had, and they were so content. And I think
just we forget to be content with what we have back at home. We are so blessed with everything, but we take it for granted, and I know I do for sure.
With your education, don't use it for material possessions as such. Don't have the disposition of getting an education just become wealthy and rich with material possessions. Have an education to become wealthy in a sense of health and to help other people get through. And that was probably the most powerful message I took away from today. Why we should follow education.
It's really hard to explain, but we've definitely all changed, and we talk about what's changed. We don't know what, we just have. And everything we look at now is different. Especially in the education field, it's great to see what an education can do, and that I know that now I've made the right choice in becoming a teacher. And even if I've changed one child's life in Africa, that's worth my while. And I'll go back again and hopefully see the same children, see their progress, and they can start changing things.